Hello, Colin. How you doing?
Yeah, good, mate. How are you?
Nice to hear your voice.
Yeah, good to hear your voice after all this time.
So, where are you right now?
I'm in Perth. I'm in a suburb called Ferndale in Perth, Western Australia. It's just getting dark. And yeah, I guess you're getting ready for lunch.
Yeah, that's right. And I noticed the Australian accent that you've absorbed over the last 10 years.
Yeah, it's funny. Some people say that I've got an accent, and then some say, "Oh, I haven't really got much of an accent." So it's, yeah, I think it just kind of it's one of those things that you pick up on wherever your environment. I'm looking forward to hearing you speak Welsh soon.
I wonder if that will happen. Colin, let's tell people how we first met. Do you remember how we met?
I do indeed. It wasn't actually on the fire, but it was at the Tony Robbins. I believe it was at Life Mastery in Scotland. I'm not quite sure whether we met at UPW or not, but we certainly cemented our friendship at Life Mastery up at St Andrews Golf Course in Scotland.
Yeah, right. Do you know what? I had forgotten about that because I thought I'd met you at UPW, but you're absolutely right. I think it could have been Scotland or UPW. I'm not exactly sure. For the people listening, they may or may not be aware. We're talking about Tony Robbins seminars, and for me personally, I first went to UPW, which is his main event. It was in London, and it was 2005 that I first went. So, when was your first exposure to Tony Robbins?
I think it was the year before, and being a bit of a lunatic, I did three, I think I did four, and went back as part of the fire team, the fire crew. Believe it or not, one year and help build the fire and help people across it. And yeah, that was a pretty amazing experience. Got up on the stage and yeah, I was jumping around. But yeah, it was about the same time.
I'll tell people what happened because these UPW events, a lot of people may have seen the documentary on Netflix, and they'll see Tony Robbins seminars are huge events, sometimes up to 10,000 people, and they last a whole weekend, 4 days. It's a lot of fun. It's like a festival. It's like an indoor rock concert festival of personal development, goal setting, working on your life, meeting new people. It's very, very positive. It's very energized. It's very motivational and all those things. It's a wonderfully, it was definitely the most powerful experience of my life, for sure, no question.
It's the only rock. It's the only rock concert I've ever been to where I actually looked inwardly at myself and wasn't concerned about the band on stage.
It's really a wonderful thing. And if anybody is thinking of going, I definitely recommend it. I don't know what the prices are like nowadays, but it's worth it. And what was your, how did you first get into it? And what did you get out of it, Colin, when you first came across the Tony Robbins stuff?
I think like a lot of people, I was looking for something. I was kind of 2004, what would I have been then? 40, 47, 48. Yeah, I was born in 56, so around 40, 45, just over 45. And I was looking for something. I'd been employed all of my adult working life. I was tired of working for the man. I'd read about all this stuff, self-development and personal development and what have you. And I'd always been very motivated and positive. And I'd been in sales all my life, so I'd had to be upbeat and focused on results and everything else. And I think I've got a feeling it was Jason Jackman. You'll know Jason from the old days, from 15 years ago. And Jason and I worked together. He had a mortgage broking business, and I had a wills and estate planning business. And we worked together a lot. And he was probably a little bit further ahead than me with the personal development stuff. And he said, "Oh, come on, we've got to go and do this Tony Robbins thing." And so we did. And he and I shared the whole journey. We did the whole series of events. We did UPW. We went back and did it more than once. Then We did, I think the next in the series was Life Mastery in Scotland, where you and I met, then Wealth Mastery, which, to be honest, I didn't get an awful lot out of, and then finally Date with Destiny, which we did in Palm Springs.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that as well. Yeah, we went to California. so it's all coming back to me now. Me and you actually did several events together, didn't we, around that time in our lives?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah,
and if Tony's listening, you know, any contribution would be useful in promoting him.
Who knows?
Who knows?
And now what am I thinking? Let me think what I'm thinking now. So, did you make any big changes in your life as a result of going to UPW?
Oh, massive changes.
Okay.
One of them being here.
Okay. Okay.
I started the wheel business a little bit before doing UPW, and it was probably I was probably floundering in the new experience of running a business, being responsible for every damn thing that happens, as you are, and so. That, you know, that drove me to learn more, to do more, to expose myself to people like Tony Robbins and various other people. And, so big changes. Well, I made a lot of changes in the business, which helped me to grow it to a point of it being worth something and selling it.
Oh,
I sold my business in England in order to move here.
Oh, right. I didn't realize.
Yeah, so the dream to come here had been just that, a dream for many, many years. And it materialized. I'm not going to say it was materialized because of those events, but it certainly made me focus on, what do I want? Why am I not getting it? And the stumbling block, of course, in most of these scenarios is that it's you who's actually thwarting your progress towards something because of the fear or whatever the issue is. And yeah, so it prompted me to take action after Date with Destiny. It made me evaluate what I was doing, and because that would have been 2005, maybe six, 2006 perhaps. And within 3 years I was here. So you could call that a massive change.
Mm. You've been through a lot of tough times as well. There's been struggles as well, haven't you? I know you've got quite ill recently, which you can tell us about. And am I right in remembering, did you separate from your wife when you went to Australia?
3 years after we got here, yeah.
Oh,
so,
okay.
I'd been previously married before as well. So I was married from the age of 18 to... I was married for about 18. In fact, both of my marriages lasted 18 years, which is kind of weird because you'd think after that long you'd be able to work on it and sustain it. But anyway, we didn't. But look, what you're saying, Ben, about overcoming challenges, I think, look, I listen to a lot of podcasts. I read a lot of stuff. And I'm not sure we spend enough time talking about the time that we're in the shadow, so to speak.
Mm.
You know, that those times when we are, it's all very well posting on Facebook, oh, I've just done this and I've just done that, and Instagram this, and everybody generally posts positive stuff. And look, I'm not decrying that because the world needs that positivity, but I think all of us, you know, I call it the shadow because it takes so damn long to come out of it sometimes. Mm. And you're right. I mean, I'm not going to dwell on past challenges that I've overcome, which have mainly been either financial or relationship-based. I don't think I haven't had any health issues at all up to July of 2015 when I was diagnosed with celiac. And for the listeners, forgive me for mentioning the chronic diarrhea that I had prior to the diagnosis, which I ignored, being a man, you know, it's no problem, I can live with that. And it went on for several months, and I lost weight And believe it or not, I'm training for an Ironman triathlon. And I went to the doctors and I said to the doctor here, this was here in Australia, I said, look, just give me a once over, will you? You know, blood test and heart rate and everything else. I'm training for the Ironman next year. And he did me the one, give me the once over, and then sent me for a blood test. And then the day after, I was actually due to fly to England because my dad was quite seriously ill. In fact, he died 3 weeks after that. But so I went to England, and then about 3 days later at 3 o'clock in the morning, my doctor in Australia called and said, just stop doing anything and everything to do with your training. And I was just shocked. I said, what's up? You know, and he said, you are completely depleted of electrolytes, minerals, vitamins, and you need to get to a doctor there in order to get a what they call a gastroscopy. I think they call it an endoscopy in England. One of the two. They stick a camera down your throat and one up the other end. And if they don't meet in the middle, you're in trouble. but no, seriously. So they found that my small intestine was severely damaged. I mean, you know, this had obviously been going on for some time. And when I got back to Australia, they continued tests and a biopsy. Showed that I got celiac disease, which it, for anybody who's not familiar with it, it's an autoimmune disease where your body basically rejects anything from the wheat and gluten cereal family. So bread, you know, all the nice things like cakes and biscuits and yeah, anything from the wheat and gluten family. So it wasn't too much of a problem. Obviously, I wasn't very well. I'd lost about a stone. And then I went on a gluten-free diet, strictly gluten-free. I always remember, and this was the wake-up call probably, I remember the gastroenterologist coming around to see me after he'd done the endoscopy. He was Polish. And he said, Mr. Chapman, you must, that's not a very good Polish accent, but Mr. Chapman, you must adhere to this gluten-free diet. And he looked me right in the eye and he said, if you do not, you will die. And I was like, fuck, this is serious. Because, you know, a lot of people, my son is actually celiac, but he can, you know, nowhere near as intolerant or as sensitive to wheat and gluten as I am. I mean, I've only got to walk into a bakery and I can, you know, basically smell it if fall, you know, fall on the floor, whereas he's a little less sensitive. But yeah, so I went on the gluten-free diet. And I actually, 2016 was a very good year. I spent about 5 months in Colorado training with a friend of mine. We were running, cycling, swimming. She was doing an Ironman and I was training with her. So I got back to pretty good fitness levels and my weight was good. And gluten-free food and gluten-free products are widely available in the US. So I never had any issues at all, not one blip. And so then I came back from there. I went to England for Christmas that year. And then I came back from England in January 2017. And for want of a better phrase, the wheels fell off. I started to lose weight, the diarrhea returned, and for that entire year, I was just, you know, on a roller coaster. And eventually, to cut a long story short, because I'm sure you didn't call me to inquire about my health, eventually, I lost 26 kilograms. Now, in English old money, that's about 4 stone.
Jesus.
So I went from 10.5 stone, and as you know, prior to your bodybuilding days, we were both as skinny as anything. We could we could both walk past a lamppost and disappear for 3 minutes. So, yeah, by sort of November 2017, I was down to 6.5 stone and badly depleted. My BMI measurement was 14, which, you know, the doctors, you know, were talking concentration camp type scenarios, you know. Anyway, they put me on intravenous feed. I was on intravenous feed for 3 weeks, and managed to get through it. I was in hospital 3 months, and the diagnosis at the end of that 3 months was, well, we think it's refractory celiac. So what the hell is that? And they said, you know, it's a rare form of celiac, which only 1% of celiac sufferers get. And there are basically two stages. One is stage one, obviously, which is manageable, but you are given to these bouts of, you know, the body saying, no, we don't like any of that stuff. And then you get the diarrhea and you have to go in and get topped up with all the necessary minerals and everything. And the other stage is stage two, where he's basically got a 5-year end plan. Because there's normally lymphomas present. And I spent the whole of last year in and out of hospital with cameras up and down and PET scans and CT scans and basically looking for lymphomas. They just had to rule out that there weren't any there. And thankfully there weren't. Mm. So, yeah, I'm back up to 60 kilograms now, which is about 9.5 stone, just over 9.5. Mm. So I need to put another stone on, but the good thing is I've got more energy. I'm back doing what I love doing, which is, you know, kayaking on the rivers here and on the ocean, running, swimming, and doing a bit of cycling.
Mm.
So I'm back to, you know, my manic 1 to 2 hours a day exercise. And thankfully, got my appetite back for the business again. So we're launching version 3 of the Home Visit Wheels business here in Perth. And hopefully this one's going to be the biggest and the best. We're looking to grow nationally and one thing or another. But I've not, you know, although those goals are, if you like, written down in my mind, they're not, what should I say? My health is more important. If I wake up in the morning and I feel like shit, then I'm afraid that meeting's going to get postponed or that appointment's going to get cancelled, you know. Whereas in the past, you just go through it, you know, you just get through it. Oh, well, you know, I'll get a good night's sleep tonight, sort of thing. Mm. So, change my priorities completely.
Yeah, of course. Ben. Oh, I was going to ask, do you have any idea or theory of what causes it?
It's a gene that's present in a lot of people. They say that you can have it for 20, 30, 40 years. It's a bit like, you know, you hear of someone's diagnosed with something, you go, wow, you know, they're the last person I would have thought would have that, and only to find they've been carrying it around for years and years, and then something suddenly triggers this gene. And it's a bit like that with celiac. I wouldn't say, well, look, the consultants have put it down to a perfect storm of stress with my dad being ill. I had to fly to England from here about 5 times over an 8 to 9 month period. Him passing away. I was then too sick to go back for his funeral. Had some business issues going on and my marriage was breaking down. Mm-hmm. And my son won a scholarship to go and play football in America, and that didn't work out for him either. So it was kind of a funny time. Whereas you'd weather one, you know, as you know yourself, you get these challenges, and if you've, you know, you can weather one or two, but I think I just had a perfect storm.
Right.
like life was going to say, no more.
Yes. Yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, I'm certainly not an expert on how the body works, but it does appear that stress is a factor in these things, isn't it?
Mm. I think we work with it and live with it, and I won't say put up with it, because I think in a lot of cases we thrive on it. I think, you know, that getting up early in the morning, that working all day and sort of giving it 110%, as the saying goes, I think we actually thrive on it, but we don't really understand what it's doing to us.
Do you think there's some drawbacks? You know, the kind of like hyper positive attitude where everything's possible and we can achieve anything we want if we put our mind. Do you think that comes with drawbacks? Do you think there's a danger to that where, you know, we run the risk of not taking into consideration the actual limits of our body and our health and, you know, our genetic factors that are beyond our control, you know?
I think you're absolutely right, Ben. I couldn't agree with you more. I think you know, with hindsight and with a more philosophical, if you like, approach to it, if you think about it, we did it from a very young age. We went for it. We were going for it constantly. For those of us that were in that space of being positive, goal setting, I want to achieve this by the end of this year, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And the one thing that we ignored completely was the effect it was having on us, or our health. I mean, how many times have you just, you know, either not bothered to eat lunch or mid-morning or whatever, and or snacked on something, or, you know, gone through a drive-through or whatever, as opposed to having something healthy to eat. So, you know, if you imagine you're driving your car at 80 miles an hour constantly, and then you go and put some low-grade fuel in it, it's something's going to go in the end, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, you know, I think you're right. I think you're absolutely right.
And I think the kind of people like us that are attracted, that we want to be successful, we want to achieve things, and we're attracted to things like Tony Robbins, we have a propensity to want to believe that we're in control of our destiny, perhaps more so than we really are. Because in life, there's a lot of randomness and chance and good luck and bad luck and being in the right place at the right time, or, you know, an unfortunate vulnerability to illness and accidents. There's all kinds of stuff that is outside of our control, and I think this is something I've become more comfortable with. You know, I used to take the attitude that, you know, we create our destiny and we're in control of everything, and actually as time's gone on, I've accepted more and more that, you know, we're not so much, you know, we are to an extent, but we're not entirely controllable. And you know, I think people like us can struggle to accept that. Do you know what I'm trying to say?
I do. I fully understand that. I mean, I'm just, you know, if you don't mind me comparing, something that you might have found, you know, you feel you're right in control, and then you're on stage or you're doing an online guitar lesson and then the damn string breaks.
Yeah.
You're not in control, Ben.
Yeah.
And you're right. You know, you, in my case, you know, trying to build businesses with people, with sales teams, with lawyers, administration people, you cannot cater for you know, one of them getting sick, one of them leaving, one of them, you know, doing something they shouldn't do. And so you're right. We're out of control most of the time. Mm. In fact, I coined a bit of a phrase. We're either manic successives or we're manic depressives.
Yeah, right.
on our journey, because we enjoy, if that's the right word, the whole pendulum of emotion and success and failure. You know, you enjoy those heights of, oh, things are going really great and blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, next minute, 6 months later, whatever, you're on the floor and you're like, oh my God, how the fuck am I going to get out of this?
Yeah.
So, you know, I think we, because of our, I won't say ability, I think because of our need, if you like, to push the barriers, to push the, you know, to push the envelope and say, well, what's next? How far can I take this? I think because of that, we experience a lot of highs and lows, whereas perhaps some people who are quite happy with their lot, and there's nothing wrong with that at all, they're quite happy with their lot. They don't necessarily experience the highs and lows of emotion in the way that people like you and I do.
Yes,
it's interesting. It's very interesting,
it's a double-edged sword. I was basically going to say exactly the same, like, because we expect so much of ourselves and expect so much of life, if we don't get it, I think it hits us harder. I think we're more kind of disappointed and perhaps even embarrassed of failing, whereas somebody who really doesn't expect to achieve a whole lot, perhaps they actually can absorb, you know, the ups and the downs with you know, they don't really expect so much in the first place, so they're a bit more malleable to the pressures of life. I don't know, this is really just
I think you're right, I think the other thing is it's the level that we set ourselves as well. So, you know, everybody, you know, even people who are employed and they're in a job and they want to seek promotion, or they want to earn more money, or they want to do this or that, or move to a different office or a different store, they all have their goals. But we have a habit or a tendency, if you like, to push those goals way out there in the universe, and the old saying, you know, you shoot for the moon, you end up landing in the stars. I think sometimes we shoot for the moon and land up in the dog shit. But, you know, I think you touched on something that's really interesting, and it's kind of giving me ideas. I love talking in this way because my brain goes into overload, and, you know, I'm thinking now how to help people curtail their loftier goals and bring them down to, and I can't remember who, was it Zig Ziglar or Jim Rohn or someone like that, brought it all down to, if you like, the marathon. And I should be au fait with all this because I've run so many marathons, and you don't get up out of bed and run a marathon. You get out of bed and you run 1 kilometer or you run 1 mile, and then you build up to it. But we seem to have a habit with business or with goals of going, yeah, we're going to get up there. And of course, I think you used the word embarrassment. I think the embarrassment is within. And often because we've made it public as well.
And something else that occurred to me is within the, let's just call it the positivity or success world, people are very quick to talk about their successes, and they often won't talk, or you won't hear about the things that gone wrong a lot of the time. And you know what I mean? It's a bit like a gambler. Like if people go to the casino, they'll talk about the times they won. They won't talk about the times they lost. And I think it's the same with everything. So it's very easy to get the impression that other people are doing great all the time, making loads of money all the time, you know, living a happy life all the time. But, you know, a lot of people go quiet.
But actually they're in therapy 3 days a week.
Yeah, right, exactly. So it can give a false impression, can't it? You can end up comparing yourself to actually an unrealistic standard, thinking everyone else has got it easy, you know, when...
But I'd like to ask you a question, Ben, if I may, and it really centres around our, you know, when we first met, we were both very, very slight, skinny almost, and your journey to where you are now in terms of your body structure, I find it quite fascinating that you've, because that hasn't been done overnight. People will, you know, look at an Instagram or a Facebook photo of you and go, wow, you know, look at that physique, as if you've always been that way. Well, you haven't, and it must have been a long journey for you. How many injuries did you sustain while you were on that journey?
Oh, nothing significant. I did strain my lower back a little bit, but I don't think it was from weightlifting. I think I jarred it in gymnastics, or doing a front landing. I don't know if you're familiar with gymnastic trampoline.
Yeah, I have. I cracked two ribs during a front landing on the trampoline.
Okay, so just for people listening, yeah, when you land on your front, if your back is quite bendy and flexible, it's quite an easy move. If you're a little bit stiff, which I was, you can end up sort of jarring your back, and that's what I did. Anyway, to cut a long story short, no, I've not injured myself from weightlifting, no.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
That's great.
And so what happened was, I'm sure you remember, around about 2012, my hair fell out. And it sort of just made me body conscious and self-aware of how I looked. And my natural reaction to that, my natural unconscious reaction, was to want to start exercising because I could control the shape of my body, you know, even though I couldn't control my hair. Anyway. Got into weightlifting. I had a friend called Jado who was sort of coaching me. He was just guiding me, telling me what to do and stuff. And I just start. And it's one of those things, like with anything, once you start seeing results, it's like a self-perpetuating thing. Then you want more results, yeah. You know, and it's like it becomes addictive. It's like, because you think, oh, I can see, wow, I got some pec muscles now, you know, and then it doesn't take long before you're just completely hooked on weightlifting. And that's what happened to me.
And did you go to the gym prior to that?
Not really, not properly. Only every so often, just out of guilt, not in a positive way, kind of thing. I used to go like once a month, just because I felt like I should. But it's funny,
so many girls were there.
Yeah, that's right. But it's funny, isn't it? There's that transition with, because as soon as people are hooked on exercise, as you know, because you're very active all your life, it's nothing to do with motivation or forcing yourself to do it.
No,
you want to do it. Like,
try. I don't need motivating.
Yeah, like nobody could persuade you not to go and exercise when you want to exercise. So there's like a shift that happens, and I think, you know, for people listening, once you get past that point, you start seeing results, and it becomes like a fun, positive reinforcement thing. It's like no amount of money could like pay you to not go to the gym after that, you know.
No, and Ben, you've done a lot of other things as I have. And for those people listening that perhaps do struggle with doing any kind of exercise, and you know, they view it as a oh no, I'm not going to do that, I can't do that. My if you like, my philosophy has always been try anything. I mean, I enjoy kayaking on the river. I enjoy walking and running and jogging, and you don't have to run, you can just walk. Go out and walk and enjoy the environment somewhere,
yeah.
Whether it be on the beach or whether it be in a forest or something like that. But try things, you know.
Yeah.
I've done table tennis, badminton, run and swum, and you know it. I think and then you discard what you don't like. I mean, I'm sure handstands was the last thing on your mind 15 years ago.
Yeah.
And yet there you are giving classes in it.
I think it's so much more important for people to do the things they enjoy. And that's going to be different for everybody, because it'll depend on people's lifestyle. It'll depend how much free time they've got. It'll depend whether they want their nervous system to be stimulated and elevated or relaxed and stuff. You know, because some people, perhaps they've got a stressful lifestyle. They got a lot on their plate. And so for them, like going to gentle yoga, meditating, that's exactly what they need. For somebody like,
or even just a walk, a walk in the forest or on the beach,
yeah,
can be the most releasing, mentally releasing and physically helpful a bit of exercise you might do in a week.
Yeah, it's going to be different for everybody. Like my temperament, I'm quite relaxed and quite calm, and my lifestyle, you know, I don't have a lot of stress. And so for me, I don't need to relax. For me, it's the last thing I need. So personally, I enjoy challenge. I want sort of difficult tasks. I like, you know, gymnastics and weightlifting and boxing and anything intense, because that's what my mind and my nervous system wants more of. But it's different for everyone. So, you know, there's no one routine that's gonna be right for, you know, it's unique for everyone.
No, definitely not. You're right. And the more, look, I think the more structured it is, like people go and join the gym, and with some memberships you can only go at a certain time, you've got to do this with the instructor before you start, you've got to do that, you know, you've got to wait for this machine, and you've got to wait, and the more structured it is, it takes away what exercise is all about. Exercise is about random body movement that allows you to feel good about your body moving. And I think, you know, I mean, look, the gyms are making thousands, millions on people that are sitting at home now watching TV, paying a gym membership of £50 a month. or in the case here, $100 a month.
Yeah.
And it happens every year. You know, they put a big special on, no joining fee. Oh, that's great.
Mm. Yeah.
Well, guess what? There's no joining fee at the beach either. And I mean, look, I am lucky here. I must admit that there are a whole plethora of outdoor stations that you could be walking around the river, and then, you know, you come across a sit-up board, a whole outdoor gym.
Really?
And you could do a bit of biceps on one circuit and a bit of shoulder curls on the other. And, you know, I think I'm very lucky here. And I know there are those around in England, but they probably don't get used so much as they do here, you know.
Mm. So presume, I think you said to me a while ago you wanted to put on more weight, and so that's why you were interested in weightlifting. Is that, did I get that right?
Yeah, you did, yeah, because sitting at home eating chips and watching TV doesn't do it for me mentally. And unfortunately, with the celiac and the with the absorption issue or malabsorption issue, it doesn't do me any good to eat loads of food anyway, because it just gets backed up and then I end up stomachache. So I think and I'm not a gym person, which is why these outdoor stations quite appeal to me. But they're not, you know, they don't isolate particularly any particular muscle. And although I'm self-motivated, if you like, and we just talked about motivation, I don't need motivating to go out and do exercise. What I struggle with is doing something that I perhaps am not looking forward to doing on my own. It's a discipline thing, and people could say, well, it must be a discipline for you to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and go run or swim or kayak or whatever. But to me, that's not a discipline. That's something I'm getting up, I'll jump out of bed and go and do that. But if somebody said to me, oh, why don't you jump out of bed and go to the gym at 5 o'clock in the morning, I'd say, now bugger off, I'll get my bike out instead. Now, if on the other hand, I lived around the corner from you and you said, look, we're going to get that scrawny body sorted and we're going to do it in the next 6 months or 12 months or whatever, I would be there. Because I find that motivation of having someone push me, you know, I find that quite rewarding, if that
right.
makes sense.
So it's like, yeah, that doing it with someone else, having that interaction, that sort of maybe a bit of community with it, conversation, that's more appealing to you than just lifting weights alone, is it?
Yeah.
It's interesting. Yeah, go on.
Go on. No, go on.
I was going to say, it's interesting because I've thought about this before. There's different activities that I enjoy doing with other people and doing alone. Like, for example, I'm quite happy to go to a class, like a dance class or a gymnastics class or a yoga class or a boxing class and be instructed and perfectly happy. When it comes to handstands and weightlifting, I like to train alone. I don't want to be with anyone else. I don't know why it is. I'm not sure. It's just that's the way. I don't know why. I just prefer it that way. And but everyone's different on that as well. Like you just said, some weightlifters do prefer to always train with a partner. Like for me, I like the daydreaming time where I can think, and that's my little meditation while I'm weightlifting. And so even that is different for everybody, you know.
But I guess, but I can see the psychology with that, Ben, because you go to a dance class or a yoga class, and you're not going there to teach it. You're going there to enjoy it, to enjoy doing that movement with other people, whereas the weight training, the handstands, the training, if you like, that's training, that's for you, whereas perhaps the classes are more for entertainment, if you like.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's a subtle sense? It does make sense. Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. The reason we do things is different, isn't it? Like that's a really good point, actually, Colin, because a lot of people go to fitness classes and I'm not saying it's wrong, but there is an element of entertainment to it, right? And a lot of the what happens is with personal trainers, they sort of have to invent a big variety of different kinds of movements and kind of complicated movements and combinations and supersets where you go from one thing to the next. And I think a lot of that is not actually directly doing anything for the body. A lot of that is just variety for the sake of entertainment, just to keep mixing it up. I'm not saying it's wrong, but really... here's the thing with bodybuilders, that is very kind of meat and potatoes. It's very boring. Bodybuilding is very boring. There's not much variety in it.
That's the word.
yeah, it is. And bodybuilders, including myself, would just do the same exercises every time, and it's very slow pace, and you sit and you rest for 2 or 3 minutes between each set. There's nothing exciting about it. But in terms of building muscle, in terms of physique and stuff like that, that I believe is really effective. And then, you know, I want to make it clear, I'm not saying either approach is right or wrong, but a lot of people want that kind of variety and entertainment, so they'll enjoy like a circuit class or a fitness class where, you know, it's going to be more like that, but it's not necessarily better as such. It's just, you know, different focus.
Yeah, and I mean, you, like you say, whether it's boring or not, you can still get into the zone with weight training and imagine that bicep growing or that deltoid growing or whatever muscle you're working. But you're right, but you couldn't afford to do that to music or to start throwing the weight around. I don't know. I know several people who have damaged themselves with kettlebells because they're throwing a weight around that they've immediately lost control of as soon as it ends up in the air.
Do you run with other people?
At the moment, no. I have done in the past, very much, you know, run, and I belong to a kayak paddling group here that goes out once a week. But at the moment, I've got to be honest, I'm relatively weak compared to where I was 2 years ago. You know, I'm going out with a mate, funnily enough, from England, on Friday for a bike ride, and I warned him. I said, look, if you start disappearing into the distance, I'm just going to stop and have a coffee and wait for you to come back.
Right. So with
because
those...
I just, you know, whereas I might have cycled at, I don't know, 20 miles an hour on average in the past, now I'm probably, you know, 12 to 15. And not necessarily sustaining that for a long period of time either. That's been the hardest thing, Ben. If we touch on the shadow I've lived in, that's been the hardest thing. It's just the complete weakness that the body has lost its muscle tone. It's lost its strength. I mean, when I came out of hospital last March, you wouldn't believe I could barely walk. You know, let alone go up a flight of stairs and I'm still finding it difficult to run more than, I don't know, a kilometre perhaps. So it's been quite debilitating. And of course, to go out with someone, whether that be to run or to swim or whatever, is embarrassing then, because they're either constantly waiting for you or the embarrassment is with you because you can't keep up with them, you know.
Yeah. It's interesting how those secondary, like there's the primary cause of suffering, which is the illness itself, but then there's those like secondary psychological layers of suffering, such as like things like embarrassment and, you know, why did this happen? You know, all that that goes with it, that adds additional difficulty to the experience.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, look, I didn't have any pain at all. In terms of pain, it's not like I was involved in a big road traffic accident and broke several bones and was in pain for several months and I had to have this fixed and that fixed. All I did was, you know, ate something and it just went through my body and that was it. Having said that, I got to tell you this story. It doesn't get any worse than this. July the 2nd, 2015, in the morning, I went to the gastroenterologist where he gave me the news that I was celiac. In the afternoon, I thought, stuff it, I'm going to go and do something fun. And I went ice skating with a friend of mine and her daughter and ended up slipping backwards. I broke my wrist, shoulder and collarbone in one go. couldn't get any worse than that.
Oh no.
So yeah, it was funny.
What was your
wasn't
diet
funny at the time?
What was your diet all your life before you got ill?
Very English. Shepherd's pie, pasta, sandwiches, you know, I mean,
anything, look, and everything.
Yeah, nothing. I've never really been that I can recall, and I might be in denial, but I can never really recall being a drive-through eater. Mm. I've been very lucky that the two people that I married have been excellent cooks, and, you know, I've taken care of the food side of life admirably, you know, spaghetti bolognese, and, like I say, shepherd's pie, and, you know, real English food. Apple crumble for dessert. Oh my God, it's making my mouth water. Hmm. Did we get off food?
So currently you're strictly no, what is it? Gluten, no wheat, is that it?
Yeah, and that doesn't, although that sounds restrictive, there are a lot more gluten-free foods available now. And Ben and I, because we're both celiac, and I live with my son Ben, he's 23, we're again quite lucky that we cook together. So we still eat, you know, beef, chili, pasta. What did I do tonight? I did Italian meatballs in pasta with vegetables. Yesterday he did Mexican soft taco shells, gluten-free, of course. Mm. And a lot of food is, you know, look, the basics, meat, veg, potato, rice, pasta, are all gluten-free anyway.
Mm.
So, and you know, we have to be careful when we're buying sauces, you know, Dormio's okay, and various different others. But we can eat, you know, a really good diet.
Mm.
And
what about
it's
dairy?
It's just the packaged stuff. There's a question mark about dairy. I went lactose free, and I'm still lactose free. But I don't think dairy has any effect. I eat a lot of cheese. I load everything up with butter, like sandwiches, and we cook with ghee butter a lot of the time. So, yeah, I don't think I've got an issue with dairy. I stand to be corrected on that, because I've not actually gone dairy free.
Mm.
So, but that's an interesting question, because it's one I've kind of, oh no, I don't have a problem with dairy, but maybe. This, you know, this diarrhea comes back for a reason. Maybe you overload with dairy, you know. Mm,
yeah.
So it'd be interesting to give that a try. But I mean, if you've ever been conscious of looking at labels, geez, the stuff in some of these stuff, you know, some of these processed foods is just horrendous. Mm. You know, everything's got milk in, everything's got soy in, everything's got sesame and those obviously that have got wheat or gluten in as a preservative we steer clear of, but even then you can't avoid the other preservatives, so don't get me started on food, that's another podcast altogether.
right yeah, it's a big topic, isn't it?
Yeah, isn't it?
I was gonna ask
what about you, do you sustain a high protein diet to stay in the condition that you're in?
Well, I'm not as buff as you think I am, but I'm not gonna. I won't argue.
I'm sure you are, dear.
So, yeah, I eat everything, and I consider myself lucky that I seem to be able to do that with no problems. You know, I don't have any particular. I don't notice any intolerances or any problems. You know, so I guess I'm just lucky like that. I can eat everything. So,
and are you a good chef? Or do you tend to eat out?
No, I'm not a good chef, and I don't particularly enjoy cooking. I tend to just snack and eat out and just throw things together. I'm not somebody who enjoys cooking, for better or worse. I like to say my talents lie in other areas.
Yeah.
And, well, in 2015, I did a bodybuilding competition. And that was when...
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, that was when I was most strict about what I was eating. And the idea, it was high protein in terms of animal protein, meat, fats, and it was low carb. And there was sort of, how can I say it? there were some more detailed things, like I would do carb cycling where you sort of you eat very low carbs for 4 or 5 days in a row, and then on the fifth day you carb back up, and I mean, in theory, that puts your body into a state where you're sort of burning fat, and then you sort of replenish the glycogen in your muscles. To be honest, I don't really know what difference that makes, but I'm just, you know, I was just going on what people were telling me, you know. I mean, I don't really know, but you kind of, sometimes you just have to just try it and see. And
I think that's where you and I are adventurous in other areas of life. Perhaps you try different things, you try different foods, you try different, you know, like you say, different cycles of eating food. I remember when Jason Jackman and I were full on training for triathlon, and we were complete lunatics, and we went on the Atkins diet once, and it was just hilarious. We just 3 tons of bacon and you know, no carbs, and just meat, and we bought these keto sticks, you know, where you're testing your ketone all the time. It was hilarious.
And how did you feel on that?
Pretty lean and mean.
Yeah,
we didn't have a lot of body fat, and I think it was a race to the bottom to see who could get the lowest body fat.
Yeah,
it was crazy, really. It was at the time when triathlon was fairly new, so it must have been about, I don't know, 20 years ago.
How did it affect your energy?
The big thing, oddly enough, and again, I think it was psychological, you know, eat Atkins and get more energy and lose weight and get more energy. And at that time, you know, professional triathletes, you'd measure their success in what their body fat was, you know, 7% or 8% or whatever, which is crazy, absolutely crazy.
But like, how did it affect your energy for the endurance of long distance stuff?
Were you okay? That was mainly shorter distance stuff. We weren't doing Ironman then. I wasn't running marathons then. I'd kind of, my last marathon was 2004 or something like that. And 2006, when I did Ironman Lanzarote. But, you know, I went through stages of doing long distance. Most of the triathlons we did were sort of mid distance, if you like, Olympic distance, which is 1500 swim, 40k bike, and 10k run.
Wow. How many of those you done?
So, I've done a few. We've done a few around England. there's a famous one. Whenever I see Jason, we always joke about the bet we had when we did the Dover triathlon. And Jason's a lot younger than me. He's probably 10 years younger than me. Yeah, he is 10 years younger than me. And so we were seeded in different age groups, so we went off at different times. And we had a bet that the 15-minute gap, if I managed to reduce it, he would buy lunch. and if he managed to increase it, then I would buy lunch. So and if you know Dover, and a lot of your listeners will probably know Dover, there's a huge hill up to the Dover Castle, a huge hill, and it comes towards the end of the triathlon. And I could see him ahead of me laboring badly, because he carried a little bit more weight than me at that time. And I just shot past him and I said, "Count down, Jason. Lunch is on you, man." Anyway, we finished the race. Lo and behold, I'd beaten him, you know, by about 16 minutes or something like that. And blow me, we get back to Bexley Heath and we say, "Right, where are we going to go?" And I said, "Well, I'm choosing, seeing as you're buying." We went up to this Mexican restaurant and we sit and eat and everything else. And the waiter comes around with the bill and he says, "Oh, I forgot to tell you, I left my credit card at home."
So you got it anyway.
Yeah. So we always have that joke every time we meet. But yeah, funny the things you remember.
I've never done anything like that. Oh, I tell a lie. A group of friends were doing a Tough Mudder, but I don't know if that really counts. That's pretty, a soft contest, isn't it?
Well, I don't know. I've never done one, actually. I always look at them and I think, knowing my luck, I'd break something, you know, break my neck in the ropes, or, you know, get an arm caught somewhere it shouldn't be.
Well, I don't know much
about
it. I mean, somebody taught me into it, but I don't know what to expect exactly. I gather it's, yeah, like an obstacle course or something.
Yeah, yeah. And there's a few in England that, you know, have got a reputation for setting fire to the hay bales and, you know, making you go through pipes that are filled with water and that kind of stuff. And I'm like, nah, maybe not.
Yeah, yeah. I thought I'd give it a go. It's not something I've done before. And apparently they've got like electric, I don't know, there's a thing where you run through and it's a live electric, so you get electrocuted as well.
It sounds like I can't remember the guy's name now, but he used to run this event, and you know, there'd be a fleet of ambulances waiting at the end.
Jesus. yeah.
You'll love it. I think as well, if you go into those sorts of events to enjoy it, then the wet and the water and the mud and everything else just becomes a part of it. I think if you take it too seriously, then that's when you don't really enjoy it.
I think that's what it primarily is, like a team building sort of bonding experience. I think as much
where's
as
where's that in Wales?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, because I don't know if you've seen any of my posts, but I joined a group of people that were going to joint venture on property investment together.
Yeah, you mentioned that. I can't say I've seen a lot of the posts, I've got to be honest.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's there's about 20 people. There's different groups in our property sort of circle, and there's about 20 of us in total, so we're going to go and do it all together just as a group thing.
That sounds good.
Yeah. Going to ask you, Colin, how are you doing for time? Are you all right for another 10, 20 minutes?
Or? I'm good, yeah. Yeah, good.
So your business, I know you're building...
Are you buying coffee or am I?
I think it's my turn. I don't know.
Okay.
Last time I saw you was 10 years ago. I can't remember. I was going to ask you, what are your other projects? I know you're focused on the wheels business and building that up. I imagine that's your primary focus, but do you have any other projects or other side hobbies on the go besides?
There's a channel swim here that takes place. In fact, there's two channel swims that take place here every year from the mainland to Rottnest Island. And so it involves, I don't know if you know much about the waters of Western Australia, but if you're going to read about a shark attack, you're probably going to read about it being in Western Australia.
Oh.
And this channel is renowned for its sharks in the water. Anyway, they have a swim there every year. Of course you would. What else would you do in Australia in shark-infested water? And so the swimmers have to have a pilot, a motorboat, a paddler, and then they swim next to the paddler. So the paddler looks after their feeding and just keeps an eye on them, make sure they're all right. And, and the boat is the direction, you know, to the island, because the tides and the swell and the winds can be quite nasty. But anyway, I've done it every year for the last, well, except last year. I missed it last year because of, you know, hospitalisation and everything. But 2 weeks ago, George, who owns the boat, and I did the Rottnest swim with a duo. So you can do teams. And then a week on Saturday, we're doing the Port to Pub, which is the same, a similar channel across to Rottnest Island. And it'll be our 10th crossing. So we're together as a pilot and a kayaker. So we're doing that for a solo swimmer.
Nothing's going to hold you back, is it?
No. Crazy, really, isn't it? You know, it's just one of those things, projects. I'll tell you what I would like to do. You remember Gerard O'Donovan?
Yes, I do. I think I met him once.
Yeah, nobleman. Well, he's building a global business. If you get a chance to talk to him. He's in something like 31 different countries with his coaching business, Noble Manhattan. And he's been a bit like me in terms of, you know, go, 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 go. And, you know, I've kind of had the rug pulled out from under my feet. But when I lived in Weymouth, Gerard and I used to live in Starbucks, you know, three times a week. We'd have world domination coffee mornings and, you know, that's what I miss the most. So one of my, I think we've talked about it just on messaging. One of my goals this year is to find someone to just brainstorm with. It's just to have a conversation like this and just see what opens up. Because, you know, when, you know, there's 3 o'clock in the morning moments when you go, shit, that's a great idea. That would be a great business. And you write it down and then you've got no one to share it with.
Mm.
And it's probably bullshit anyway, but something someday will come up. And, so I miss that. I haven't been able to find that kind of, I want to say mentor, friend. You know, there's plenty of people I've met here in the 10 years I've been here, plenty of people I have coffee with. And yeah, and they come from all different sort of walks of life. But I want to make use of my knowledge now, Ben. I don't know if this makes sense, but I've read 400 or 500 books on various different things. I mentor at a local primary school where I have been for the last 10 years since I've been here. I go in and either mentor a student one-on-one, and this is primary school, and they either haven't got a male presence in their life or they're struggling in some way. And I also go into years one and two and do reading classes. And I kind of want to – I mean, I've always given back. You know, I've always done something for charity or – you know, run an event or whatever. But I feel like now I've reached that point where I'm this vast jug of knowledge, and I need to impart it to, you know, not necessarily the next generation. And I know this sounds a bit, you know, altruistic, but I think if we don't share what we've learned, we're doing a disservice to, you know, the next generation who perhaps are struggling. And it's almost like we live life backwards, because now we learn, now I've got a thirst for knowledge, whereas at school I couldn't wait to get out the gates. And we almost, when we can learn at our own pace and read what we want to read and do what we're interested in ourselves, I think we owe it to do something, you know, not necessarily. And I've done a lot of coaching, you know, sports coaching, sports psychology, goal setting and all that kind of stuff. And I think, you know, that might be the next thing. Because I've done a lot of sports stuff as well, as you know. When I started the wheel business, I wanted to have something else in case that didn't work. And I did a sports therapy qualification, funnily enough, in Cardiff with the Welsh Sports Massage Institute.
Right.
Based in Cardiff. And I've been lucky enough to be part of massage teams in 11 countries, working with professional athletes and, you know, just weekend warriors. And, yeah, I've done 2 Olympics. And sport's my passion. You probably hear the tone and the tempo of my voice elevates every time I speak about sport and that kind of thing. Whereas, you know, talking about wheels, which thankfully we haven't done too much of, is kind of the bread and butter. I mean, I get excited about growing the wheel business, but it's business is business, if that makes sense.
Mm.
I enjoy the interaction with people in that business.
Mm.
And the sports stuff has really, given me what's the expression? You know, it's given me the jam on the bread and butter, if you like.
Mm, I see. Yeah.
So I see.
So I sort think, of yeah, mentorship I think I'd like and to do, teaching.
Yeah, I'd like to do something. I mean, I don't want to harp on about education, because there's a lot of people trying to fix education, and there's a lot of things wrong with education, and I'm certainly not the one to fix them, because I'm the least educated person you'll meet. But I think there are kids going through school now, and there's no, how can I put it? There's just no, they have a path to follow. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You know, they go to school, they go to college, they go to uni. Well, okay, but what happens then?
Yeah, yeah.
And I think we've always struggled with, well, actually, there is an alternative. You don't have to go to college. You don't have to go to uni. What you could do, you could put that off and try this or try this. Or what do you enjoy doing? Do you know what I mean? It's a series of mentoring and questioning people. And you know, look, at the end of the day, 70% of kids might turn around and say, oh, I just want a job. Mm. Well, that's fine. But if you pick up some of that 20-30% that actually want to do something and follow our path, if you like.
Mm.
And I'm not saying that's the right path to follow. What I'm saying is that there doesn't appear to be an alternative.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, conventional education is really becoming more and more outdated, and it is so long-winded and so expensive, and, you know, kids just go through it just for the sake of doing it, and they come out saddled with debt that they can't even escape through bankruptcy, and it's just like one big sort of it's a big financial racket in some ways, isn't it, you know, because it just saddles people with debt. Yeah,
well, I mean, that's where it ends at university. It starts at primary school when teachers are under pressure to get results.
Mm.
You know, I hear mums at the school where I'm at, oh, Johnny's got this test he's got to do over the weekend. If he doesn't do well, teacher's not going to be very happy with him. Mm. He's 6 years old, for God's sake. Mm. Let him go out on his scooter.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, just anyway. Let's not go down that road. Yeah, that's a few big more people.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, there's a lot to improve, isn't there? There's a lot of things, lot of things broken in the world. I agree.
Speaker's corner in Hyde Park was made for me now.
Yeah, you're not allowed to speak there anymore, though.
Oh, really?
Well, you're allowed to speak about certain things and not others, you know.
Yeah. So, if we're winding up. And I have no interest, because I'm not politically motivated whatsoever, whether it be with Australian politics, UK politics, or whatever. Tell me about Brexit. What's going to happen?
Well, interesting question. I actually don't have strong feelings on Brexit, because I'm fundamentally, I'm a libertarian. I'm a free market guy. I'm a free enterprise guy. I don't want government to be regulating or doing anything. I don't particularly care if it's the British government in Parliament or the European Parliament in Brussels. I don't particularly care. You know, from my point of view, taxation is theft and I want to be left alone. And so I'm not somebody who particularly, I haven't really taken much interest in it. I don't particularly care. I think what I see is that the usual people that get hysterical about everything are predictably hysterical about Brexit, you know, and they're acting like it's the end of the world and everybody's going to get deported and the economy's going to crash and, you know, it's going to be Armageddon and everybody's a racist. And, you know, they're doing their whole hysteria thing, as they always do, which I find a bit ridiculous. You know, I think the world will go on. I think Britain will be fine. Yeah, I'm not particularly worried about it in either direction myself.
No. It's funny you should say that, because I lean the same way. I have no interest at all. And before you were born, there was a lady called Margaret Thatcher. And you probably remember, if you don't, well, you won't remember, but you'll be aware of the furor that she caused when she got into power. And people used to go absolutely ape about, oh, Maggie Thatcher's a bitch. And Maggie Thatcher. And I used to say, you know what? Actually, I'm making more money under Maggie Thatcher than I did under Harold Wilson or whatever his name was.
Mm.
Because if you focus on your own ends, it doesn't matter who's in power, does it? It doesn't matter what government are in.
Mm. Mm.
You know, yes, things affect you indirectly, but if you get on with it, as you say, you're going to make money and you're going to enjoy life. And
Yeah,
I think you're right. People allow it to affect their affect them, affect their lives, and
it did have a big, I mean, it's had a profound effect. As soon as Trump ran for president and got in office, I completely changed, I had to change my friendship circles. It completely reconfigured the people that I could be friends with, because half of the, well, majority of people I was surrounded by went completely insane and hysterical, and I couldn't really be friends with them anymore, because it became obvious they were start raving mad, you know. So my life, I wouldn't say my life changed a lot, but my, you know, I rethought who I was friends with and who I wasn't, and what kind of circles I was hanging around with, because you know, I was into kind of liberal arts, you know, dance and circus and in those kind of environments, and they're full of hard leftists, you know, sort of you know, social justice warriors who think all men are rapists, and you know, the evil patriarchy is suppressing women, and you know, and their mind is just full of this stuff. And my life, yeah, you know, I backed away from a lot of people and reconsidered who were the kinds of people I want in my life after that.
I think that, you know, you're right to do that, because I think everybody is entitled to an opinion, whether that be an opinion about Donald Trump, whether that be an opinion about Brexit. Everybody's entitled to an opinion. It shouldn't test a friendship anyway, should it? If you think about it, you know, you might smoke and I don't. Well, we're good friends, and that's it. You know, it's kind of, yeah, I do find it. Like you say, people go absolutely ape over some things and they have no control over them. It's quite odd.
It's very, very over the top, isn't it? It's I think, yeah. So strange times from that regard. It's very strange times the last 3 or 4 years.
So you didn't you didn't move to Wales hoping to escape all the Brexit stuff, because Wales is going to declare independence and carve a niche out of the Channel.
Pretty much. I mean, Bristol's a liberal hotspot, and yeah, I did leave Bristol to get away from that. I did, yeah, yeah. I'm not. Yeah. It's. I mean, yeah, basically.
Yeah. Oh, cool.
Yeah.
So, and you went somewhere where you had some roots, did you, or you just sort of said, okay, I'm going to stick a pin in the map, and that's where I'm going?
Yeah, pretty much. A little bit of both. I got some friends over here who, funny enough, I had met at Yes Group, you know, back in the day, you know, when around about the same period of time when we had first met, and yeah, I hadn't really stayed, you know, much in contact with them over the years. I sort of lost contact a little bit, but I've sort of rekindled old friendships from the personal development and, you know, businessy circles. And I've realized that those are the kind of people I really want in my life, you know, sort of ambitious people that that want to be successful, people that don't have a chip on their shoulder, people that aren't anti-capitalist, you know, and all that. And so yeah, I've become much clearer about who I do and I don't want in my life, and so yeah, that was part of the reason. Yeah,
that's great.
Yeah, so I'm much happier, you know, doing more focus on more business stuff. I've stopped going to yoga, stopped going to dance. I can't be around it no more. You know, it's just a shame. But
yeah. So what's next? I must interview you, actually. We'll have to schedule a reverse interview.
I'd be happy to.
What's next on the horizon for Ben Lowrey Enterprise?
Well, I've got several projects. I mean, I'm going to carry on doing my handstand workshops, because at this stage, it's ticking along nicely. It's quite good fun, and it's sort of money for old rope at this stage. You know, I can keep teaching, and I've already accumulated enough skill to be able to teach most people, and so I've gone over the hump of, I've put all the effort in, and now I can just sort of kind of, you know, harvest the benefits of it, and so that's fine. The hen parties I carry on doing, because they're you know, they're quite easy, they're quite fun, and it's kind of bread and butter, you know, sort of, it's kind of easy money. So the property joint venture group really is one of my major projects that, you know, that'll be a long-term project that if all goes well, we'll sort of, you know, slowly accumulate properties over time, and that'll just gently build. So that's quite exciting.
You're looking at Wales for acquiring property, are you?
Yeah, pretty much. That was part of the decision coming over here as well. The houses are a lot cheaper in Wales, and so it just makes it, it's more within reach to do things. But also, I'm really open to new business ventures, and even the podcast is turning out to be quite a nice networking tool, because it's nice, you know. I have conversations with people and we talk about all kinds of interesting things, and then, you know, other people listening to it, and then I might promote people's products and services and get a commission, and there's always some, you know, there's always some way of doing a deal or getting involved with something, or you meet something, you know, there's quite a lot of potential just from doing this as well.
Yeah,
and so I like that, but yeah, I'm really open. I could probably do with another couple of business projects, so I'm kind of open to possibilities as well, because I do love business. I love a challenge, and also I think business for me, I experience it as a creative process as well. It's like creating a solution to a problem, you know. I find that very exciting, and then the possibility of, you know, the, you know, making profit as well, I find that really great fun, you know, to and so I
yeah just open. To see just to see it develop from an idea to something of substance.
I've got a friend called Chris who's like he's got a business called Incubate, which he partners with businesses and grows them, and he takes a share of the company in exchange for growing the business, and he's involved with loads of different things. I'm not exactly sure what we're going to do together, but we're going to like partner up and do something, and, you know, I'll get involved with what he's doing. I'm not sure yet, but there's stuff like that is what I'm looking for. Yeah.
And that's the exciting bit. What you just said is I'm not sure yet. And, and that to me opens up endless possibilities. You know, when, you know, people that say, oh yeah, and I'm going to do this, and it might well be something that they've researched and they've done a lot of work on, but I think, like you've just said, when you say something like, I don't know what it looks like yet, it's exciting.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, future possibility is essential, isn't it? You know, because you've got to feel like there's something in the future to look forward to, because the minute you don't feel like there's a future, that's a scary place then, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, and a big go-to speakers club as well, which is quite fun.
Is that like Toastmasters?
So that's another little kind of hobby that I've taken on, and I'd love to get into stand-up comedy, but I can't figure out a way in yet, because I need to learn more about it. But in the back of my mind, that potentially is something I'd like to get into.
I think the idea with stand-up comedy is that you find a bar or a club that use plastic glasses first, and then you build from there.
Yeah, you could be right. But you know, I like a challenge. So to me, that the idea, you know, I always remember I heard Mike Tyson say, he said, if there's no possibility of being humiliated, then it doesn't interest me. You know, I have to stand the chance of sort of losing everything, because only with that pressure will you be sort of drawn to be your greatest self. You know, it's like all or nothing, you know, real extreme. And I like that, the possibility of being humiliated. And that's the kind of challenge that I like to rise to, you know.
And what a transformation he's gone through.
Incredible.
Yeah, just amazing.
Yeah,
all that aggression, he's so passive now and thoughtful, and
yeah fascinating. Incredible. Guy, really interesting guy.
Cool.
Well, all right, Colin, it's been great speaking.
Ben, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for having me on the podcast, and I look forward to catching up with you again soon.
Yeah, we'll speak again soon.
Yeah, for sure.
All right.
Have a good afternoon.
Have a good day. You too. Cheers. Bye.
Cheers, Ben. Bye.